This is KLEAN Radio.
Welcome everybody out there listening to KLEAN Radio on all our stations out there, all our many stations. My co-host with the most is back this week, Andrew.
Yeah, I'm back from New York.
Who? How was it? I know you're going through a rough family time.
Yeah, it was very cold. It was like between minus 6 and minus 11.
And, you know,
it was like,
all the time we talk about seasonal, we've spoken about this on the show in the past, about seasonal
affective disorder.
Yeah. And you're going from 80-degree weather to Ithaca, New York. It's not like Manhattan. You went to...
No, I was in upstate New York, like central New York.
Right.
Yeah, it was freezing cold. I couldn't believe it. I was like, it's like the coldest winter in like a long time.
So did it affect you at all?
Yeah, it was horrible. Yeah. I was like, get me back to California. I don't know how people do the cold thing. I grew up there for a long time, so...
So did I.
You'd think I'd be fine, but no, it was like extraordinarily cold. I was just like, you know, and it was just gray and dark.
So,
you know,
very uplifting.
Not fun. Yeah, I was so glad to get back. I like got off the plane, and even with the smog, it was still brighter than like, you know.
That's when you start changing in the bathroom on the plane, you know. It's, you just start putting your shorts on, getting prepared.
Well, that's the thing. I have like no winter clothes. So yeah. I went up to, you know, New York. I've got like, you know, 14 hoodies and 3 pairs of jeans on. I can't even button the top ones. You know, it was really ridiculous.
So everybody out there, welcome to KLEAN Radio and welcome back, Andrew. Give us a call. The number here is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. I'd like to welcome everybody out there that found us via Facebook, because we had a bunch of Facebook callers last week. And if you want to find us on Facebook, go to facebook.com/KLEAN Radio. Some really interesting things. You know, we have an amazing guest tonight. We'll get to him in a second. He's founder of one of the greatest punk bands of all time, T.S.O.L. He's also become an acclaimed author. Jack Grisham will be joining us in a second. But one of the things, and I want to get his opinion on this. You know, obviously in the news right now, we got Bieber fever, but for the wrong reasons.
And was there ever a right reason?
Yeah. But, you know, and it's like the first reaction everybody has, you know, you see this 19-year-old, you know, different type of punk than Jack was legendary for. And this kid, you know, and I'm thinking about it, take everything aside, take your feelings for him out of you know. Gets pulled over in a Lamborghini, so he's basically...
I thought it was Ferrari.
Or Ferrari, I think it was, whatever, you know, going 90, however, drag racing. He's literally has a loaded weapon. And I think that's the point where people don't, you know, people... That's the take I have it on, is the drunk driving, you know, he gets pulled over, he talks about, you know, drinking, doing antidepressants, which really, it's a weird combo, Andrew.
Well, and smoking, they counteract each other.
And I just, you know, I actually feel bad for the, you know, for the kid, because it's going to be, you know, if he needs help, it's going to be hard for him to get help.
It's just, you know, it's another Leif Garrett kind of situation, you know, teen idol, lost his way. Hopefully he's got some money stacked away. And
well, he made $58 million
doesn't kill
last
himself.
Yeah. So well, let's welcome to KLEAN Radio, Jack Grisham. Yeah, what a lead-in.
Yeah,
Justin
right?
Bieber to Jack.
Jack survived his teen idol years.
Am I on here?
Yes, yeah, you are. Just a little closer to the mic. It'd be good.
All right, there I am.
Yeah, there you are.
Yeah. Yeah, it's nice. I mean, whatever. I like to see the pictures of him. Is that wrong of me? They had a good one where it was like Miley Cyrus with her makeup on and then Justin without it on.
I just think that they're the same person. Well, have you ever seen them in the same room?
The same.
They look exactly the same. Okay. Same haircut, same tongue thing. Like, what's up with that tongue thing? Like, what drug do you have to take to think that tongue thing is the right thing to do?
Apparently, we have no sympathy for Justin Bieber tonight on KLEAN Radio. But, Jack, I mean, you know, you started, obviously, the legendary band T.S.O.L. You still tour with it today.
Right.
And did drugs derail you guys at all? Or is that a funny question? This is sort of like a...
No, it's not.
Yeah. It was rhetorical.
See, for me, I struggled with, like, believing that I had a problem. Like, I argued with that because I didn't know what a problem was.
Right.
You know, like, somebody would go, hey, you got a problem? It's like, no, I'm drinking, dude. And they'd go, you're an alcoholic? It's like, no, I'm not. And they go, well, you're blacking out. It's like... Yeah. Did you see how much I drank? Did you see how much I drank? And then they'd go, yeah, but you pissed yourself too. It's like, yeah, I was blacked out, genius. What do you want? You know, and I didn't get it. And my whole list, I had a list of what I did. It's like, okay, well, I'll do hash. I enjoy hash because that's a gentleman's drug. And I'll take mushrooms because those are fun.
That's the first time I've heard hash referred to as a gentleman's drug.
It's a gentleman's outside of Egypt.
But I love the way, you know what you're talking about right now is you're talking about what alcoholics do in their mind to create the image that it's okay.
Plus the denial.
Yeah. A little cocaine, some Ativan, you know, whatever it is. Some Valium, some Ativan. You know, once I found Ativan, it's like, oh, who wants Valiums? Because now I don't wake up depressed. You know, it's nice. And
takes the sadness out of it.
That's not, you know, so it was all high school. And I used to say, why don't shoot up? Right, you got a problem because you shoot up, champ.
You know, that's, I think that, that's, I think though, issue. You know, there is a generational thing to that. Because, you know, I remember like in the 80s, like, you know, growing up, we're about the same age. So, you know, shooting up was a much, much bigger deal than it's become today. Like, people seem to slip over that line quicker.
Yeah, tattoos were a bigger deal. Yeah.
Oh, man, I had like one of the first tattoos in my town. And people thought I was like, I was out of control. In fact, I was just, I was back in Ithaca. I went to visit where I went to school, right? And so one of the professors at the college that I was at, he was like, you know, you were like one of the first guys I ever knew with tattoos. He's like, you really started something. You're ahead of your time. I'm like, yeah, now I'm just like everybody else. I'm like, great.
Yeah. Well, I remember back then, like, you see a girl with a tattoo. It's like, yeah, she's in. I mean, like, you knew that she had been downtown on the bus a number of times.
Well, they were illegal. You know? People don't even realize it was illegal in most states. Yeah. Like, New York was illegal to have tattoo parlors. They had, like, and people worried about AIDS, and there was a lot of Hep C going around, and too, with tattoo parlors. So, you know, when I was like 18, you couldn't even get a tattoo. You had to go to like Mexico or like San Francisco. I got my first tattoo at Lyle Tuttle's place on 7th and Mission.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah. So,
but you, you, you realize you're speaking to somebody with
Lyle Tuttle did like Janis Joplin. Yeah. He did like Janis Joplin's tattoos that's and like famous. Jimi Hendrix. Yeah. He was like the first really major like rock and roll tattoo guy.
It's we used to funny. Go to the Pike.
Oh, yeah?
After we went down to Burt Grimm's, Rick Walters and those guys down at Burt Grimm's. That's but I never had one on me. Never. Like, like I'm still, like, look at my arms. They're clean. I only have one tattoo on me, right? And it was in a blackout.
Yeah, we don't want to see that one.
Well, it's no big deal. It's a half-done broken heart on my tit, man. And because I'd always tell those guys, I don't mark my body. I don't mark my body. And I wake up one morning, and I got this patch on my tit, and I come out of a blackout.
I'm trying you can say that word on the radio.
Yeah, right? Well, it's like, I come out of the this blackout, and I look at this big bandage on my tit, and I go, oh, my God, I've been shot. You know? And then I peel it off, and it's a half-done broken heart on there. You know, it's like,
wow. It could have been a lot worse. It could have been a lot worse.
Did you ever figure out how it was you got that?
I know exactly how I got it. I know how it started. Like, stuff started getting a little clear. You know, a couple of cocktails, and all of a sudden the world is cruel. You know? Like, I was one of the, I'm a late-night phone call guy.
Yeah,
and I was stoked.
Drunk dialer?
I found out that Judy Garland used to make late-night calls, too, so I go, I'm just like Judy.
So even then you romanticized it.
That's right. Right. And then I'd be up writing letters and stuff. You know, it's just, I had a friend, what I don't want to get, I had a friend because we always get separated, and he knew I'd be at home crying like late at night. So 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, he'd come knock on the window, go, you in there, Jim? I'm coming in, right? He'd lay down in the bed, and he'd go, just lay down, man. Just lay down. And I'd be up solving problems and stuff, you know. And one morning I wake up, you know, and I'm in bed, and somebody's next to me. I'm thinking, okay, you know, I don't know where I was, but this is good, you know. And I roll over and I put my arm around her, you know. I go, oh man, I go, this chick's big. She's big, right? And then I'm like coming to for a second. I go, oh my God, I'm in bed with a man at my mother's house. You know? Then my buddy wakes up and goes, get your hand off me. You
know? So it's like that scene from Planes, Trains, and
Automobiles. Same thing.
Way over the top. And if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio. That's Jack Grisham, founding member of the amazing punk band T.S.O.L. and also back in studio tonight, of course, Andrew Spanswick. So give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. So you know what I love what you're talking about? And for people that just tuned in that are listening that are going to hear us laughing at these stories, they're going to be like, what is wrong with these people? And I think some of the things that are we've learned to embrace it. You know, you years later or even, you know, you come to look at your stories and either you're going to, you know, some people relapse or don't get sober. The ones of us that do get sober have to laugh.
Yeah, I totally agree. And it's funny because I was just talking about somebody. I heard this woman say one time, she said she lives with the memories of another woman, which is true. I mean, because there's been some shift in thinking. There's been that psychic change or whatever. And I feel like that. I have guys ask me sometimes, well, do you feel remorseful? It's like, well, not really. I don't really feel remorseful for another man's crimes because it's almost like it's not me.
Right.
You know, so it's real interesting, like looking back at this stuff, and it's kind of like a third party when you look back at it. You're discussing somebody that isn't there anymore. Like, I don't resemble the person that I was when I walked in here, you know? So, I know.
Yeah. I mean, remorse, I think, is an active state of still dealing with the problem. I mean, you know, if you're sort of over that problem, not that you ever fully recover, but, you know, if you're sort of over directly dealing with it and you've moved on to more parts of your life and your life expands, then remorse isn't really necessary to feel to make yourself have to do something.
Right. But there were years of remorse.
No. Yeah.
Like when I woke up, Yeah. You know, it was like, this is bad news, man. Yeah, right. I always tell somebody, when somebody says, oh, you come into the program or whatever, here's what you get sober. I say, what, you're offering that to me? That doesn't sound good. You got another option? Well, it's like, what's option two here? Yeah, right. Sober ain't good.
But behind curtain number three.
But even that attitude is a great attitude because, you know, we obviously got sober in the same 12-step world. And I was, you know, it's this myth, and I think sometimes more in L.A., that you have to be happy when you come in and you get sober. And the ones I noticed that stay sober really are angry for, you know, hate it, you know, right. But stay.
Yeah, and they need to be angry. Yeah. Like, I used to have this friend that say, if you're happy to be here, you're too sick to stay, man. You know, there's an issue here. And I always tell the new guys, tell us the truth, man. Like, if you're familiar with 12-step groups, like our policy is love and tolerance. Like, we have to love you. So I always tell, you know what I mean? I tell the new guys, hey, don't blow smoke up our asses. Come in and tell us exactly how bummed you are, how much you hate the speaker guy. Let us know that your coffee commitment blows. Like, tell us the truth. Because you could stand up in the middle of one of those groups, flip us all off, tell us to go to hell, and we just clap until you keep coming back. Right. Right. You know? It's like, so give it to us the truth from the start.
It's like, I one time heard somebody say, it's like the only fellowship, you know, in the 12-step world where you could have like a day sober and they give you the keys to the room and make you the treasurer a week later. They're like, great job.
Every once in a while you'll hear those stories. Like somebody will go, oh, do you go to so-and-so? I go, yeah. And they go, my uncle used to go there. He was pretty big. I think he was secretary or treasurer. Yeah, your uncle sounds like the man. Yeah, I mean, speaking of that, like so much of that crap, the only person that's important down there is the coffee maker. That's it. You know,
I couldn't agree with you.
I mean, the rent's been stolen. It's like, and then you'll
remember the Key Club meetings, they kicked him out of there because somebody was like, finally, they figured out people were stealing bottles of liquor from behind the bar.
After a couple years.
I mean, you know, you get the secretary, who cares about that? Treasurer, rent's been stolen. Right. You know, the speaker, you get these guys. I'll tell you, man. And I don't know if it's maybe because I came out of like playing music or being on stage my whole life. Like some of these guys get sober and then all of a sudden they act like rock stars, like 12-step rock stars. Yeah.
That's that whole AA guru thing,
it's
right?
It's crazy, man.
Like all of a sudden, it's like their only life's identity is like being an AA. It's like, dude, the point is to go there and then start a life. It's not to become like some, like, if you want to do that, you know, become a clinician. AA is not treatment. You know what I mean? It's like,
it's crazy. Yeah. You see so much of it. And I get these guys going, I have 50 sponsees. Yeah. It's like, dude, I used to collect army men too when I was a kid. I love the flamethrower guy. That's my favorite, you know?
He's trying to get the parachuter.
Yeah. It's like, really, guy? And they run the same game, like the same game that they ran out on the street.
Right.
Yeah. Now it's like, hustle, well, I can't run it there. Now I got to run it in here. I got to control these people. I got to do this. I tell people all the time, don't let these people make your world small.
Yeah.
Don't let them make this spiritual experience small. It's like, knock down the walls in here. Start, you know, it's wide open, man. Live.
And if you just tuned in, you are listening to Clean Radio, so give us a call. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. That voice you hear is Jack Grisham, founding member of T.S.O.L., but also who's become a very acclaimed writer. Your last book, it did really well 3 years ago. I remember you were, you know, that's when it first came out, I believe, and you came on our show when we were in a different station.
Loved it. And right by my house.
Yeah.
And you're right.
We made him, drive to L.A. No.
Sorry about that.
Yeah. But it's a Sunday.
These wimpy Orange County boys, man.
I live down by the beach, you know what I mean? I'm up and down Pacific Coast Highway. I got 200 yards of garden hose, and that's as far as I need to go, man. You know, I get in the car, and all of a sudden, it's a whole different deal.
That's what your wife did? You got married and she hooked you up to the garden hose?
My wife's the best. Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, I ran into this girl. And it was
congratulations,
just,
by the way.
Oh, thank you very much. Yeah, it's really, I'll tell you, you know, I'm actually in one of those relationships that people talk about, but you don't really believe it's real.
Wow.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, we don't have a harsh word. Like, if we get angry with each other, we say, hey, I'm going to take a minute out. We'll reconvene. Let's calm down. We go and we reconvene. We discuss our problems. We share our feelings. It's like there's not like yelling and screaming. It's like our biggest argument is, I'm not happy with that. That's it.
Right.
But a lot of love and a lot of fun, man. We have great parties at the house. I live in a cool old haunted house, too. That's
and he gets tell haunted us about these parties because he knows we're not driving an hour and a half to get there.
Right.
He's like, come to the house next week for the party. Let's go to Heather, who wants to check in. Heather, welcome back, as always, to Clean Radio.
Hey, Heather.
You're here with Jack Grisham and Andrew Spanswick.
Hey. good to hear you. Andrew, I have to laugh at you. You're complaining about the cold in New York. Try living in Vermont.
Oh, yeah, I know. Well, you know, I guess at some point it doesn't make a difference. You know, minus 11, I mean, you know. Think of the shift I had to make. It was like 90 degree shift.
That's right. You acclimate. You get used to it.
You do get used to it. I think like you break in, but when you go from like on out of LA and then land in like negative 11, it's a little bit of a shock to the system.
But Heather actually posted on Facebook. She goes, why is it that I always wear jackets in the studio? She asked if it's cold. And I think, it's not why.
It's because he's cool.
Yeah, I feel secure in a hoodie. Yeah. You know,
it's like one of those jackets they make dogs wear now to win. Yeah. Like the lightning jackets that compress the dogs so they feel safer.
Seriously?
It's like, yeah, have you ever seen these things?
No, I'd like to get one, though. Yeah. That sounds really nice.
Oh, it's the infomercial, you know.
Yeah, it's like this thing squeezes the dog, and it makes it, like, feel more comfortable so it doesn't bark at lightning.
Okay. So let's get to Heather.
So
Heather,
that's what you got on,
you?
Judah.
Yes, it is.
Your lightning jacket.
Not tonight. I have a hoodie.
It's been a mixed bag. Okay. On the positive side, okay, I got to reveal myself as being a geek. I went to a science fiction fantasy convention. I had a good time, and I got to practice flirting, and it was fun.
There you go. Wow. That's the best place to flirt, too.
Right?
Because even if they say no, they're it's a sci-fi convention.
And how do they say no? Like, you don't even know you're getting rejected. It's great.
Vulcan. So what happened?
It was fun. Well, one person is somebody that I knew from years ago when I was in my 20s who I used to flirt with. So it was somebody old that I flirted with, and then I went into a gaming room and played some games, and there was this guy who was teaching the game, and he had smiling eyes, and so I flirted.
Okay, so just so Jack knows, Heather's sober a little over 15 years. She's going through a divorce recently, and she's been going through stuff. So for her going to this sci-fi convention and getting her flirt on is amazing progress.
Yeah, it's killer.
Yeah, right.
Do they wear costumes?
Yeah, I was going to ask, what did you wear?
Yes, they do. I even wore a costume myself.
What was it?
What'd you wear?
Describe it in great detail.
Well, it was from Star Trek Episode 6. Yeah, right.
Heather,
what were you wearing, Heather?
Oh, I was wearing like a medieval outfit, although I put on a brown bowler hat to make it look like a steampunk.
Oh, that's kind of cool. Huh.
Yeah. Hey, I know this guy, and his daughter is young. She's really young. She's like 12 or 13, and she makes those, you know, the cosplay where they wear the animal suits?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
This kid rules at making these animal suits, like foxes and owls and stuff. But some people use it for adult games, but she does it because she's a kid. And so the dad sends me pictures from these conventions of all these animals wander around, and she does like the daytime show, and then late night the animals go somewhere else, you know. But she doesn't go to those, you know.
So Heather Jack is offering you advice on your next costume.
Yeah, well, maybe she could get a furry suit because she could flirt.
No, I'm not a furry.
If you're not there yet, don't.
Don't let Jack steer you down the wrong path. And his books are a little bit of debauchery in there. So,
Heather, have you been making meetings, doing your gym stuff?
Well, less so. I was sick for like a week, and then I went away on the weekend. So, it's been a couple, 2 or 3 weeks or so since I've done that stuff. But
well, no time like the present, as they say.
Yeah.
But I'm really happy that you're living life because you're going to a sci-fi convention. And I got to tell you, and I'm going to say this. Everybody wants to go, but I don't think they have the courage to go. Okay, who doesn't want to go to a sci-fi convention of some sort?
Galaxy Quest. You ever see Galaxy Quest?
Yes, I love Galaxy Quest.
Yeah, I mean, it beats the alternative. I mean, personally, things are going well with me.
Wait, can I ask a question, Heather? What's the alternative? Wait a minute. I'm going to a sci-fi convention. What is the alternative to that?
Okay, well, the alternative was the bad news part of what I was going to be sharing. Oh. You know, I live in a town of a population of 2,500, and there was a very public suicide that affected the community and a lot. Mm. And since I work with people who have a lot of mental illness and also with drugs and stuff, you know, a lot of people have been really affected by it. And they have a little memorial because the person actually, you know, killed himself at his place of business at a pizza place. So it was nasty. You know, and a lot of people are hurting. So, you know, I'd much rather, you know, be not in the community when they're mourning, and I was at a science fiction convention.
But listen, you have to live your life, Heather, and you've done a lot of mourning, you know, and you've done a lot of you know, soul searching and all that stuff, you know, you're allowed to enjoy life.
Yeah. I mean, as it is, the other bad news is my cat is having health issues, and I'm going to probably have to put him on a feeding tube. So it's fatty liver disease. So, you know.
Well, Jack can tell you about feeding tubes. That's his new thing.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, whatever. I don't want to make that a cat. That's like a little person.
It's my baby.
Yeah. I was going to say, I have a fluffy white dog. Go to the next sci-fi convention and have the cat with a tube in its mouth.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, it's like, here's Mr.
Hey, Jack said it.
Here's Mr.
Get one of those costumes and have a feeding tube.
Here's Mr. Whiskers.
I actually have a picture of my dog on a fake IV that I send to people when they're in the hospital. It makes them laugh.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, that's
right.
So. Maybe you should go visit them. It might make them laugh, too. Heather, I'm really sorry for what you're going through, Heather. But it also sounds like you're
getting out and doing well.
Getting out and doing well.
Yeah. And I have, I have plans. One of the people that I flirted with, I'm seeing in a couple of weeks.
Oh, there you go.
It's on.
Remember my rules of dating?
You know Judah's rules, right?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Make sure he opens the door
to the
for
cheapest.
You.
He's got to open the door for you, and you got to go to the cheapest restaurant possible start out with.
You got
to
work your way up.
Which I think is wrong, but this is Judas' rules, and he got two people to agree with him last week.
One is in a mental institution, and one's going through a rough time. So, Heather, I'm hoping you might disagree with me.
I hope you get to go somewhere nice, Heather.
Yeah.
I will let you go, but your show is awesome, and it's lovely. I'll look forward to hearing the rest of your show.
Thank you so much, Heather.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Yes, Jack?
Well, I was going to say, since we were talking about dating, my wife has three kids, and I have two kids, but I got the one with me, right? And then we got a bunch of friends. So when we started seeing each other, we were not alone for a month. Our dates would be 8 or 10 people. Like, it was like, seriously, it was like, you know that scene in The Godfather where Michael Corleone, he's walking and the girl's walking way away and the family's...
Yeah, and the two women are behind them.
It was seriously like that for a month. I mean, we didn't even kiss. We were never alone for a month. And the only thing we could do was write emails back and forth.
I won't even ask what those were.
No. It's actually, you know, it was actually really cool. If you take the electronic out of it, what you're basically doing is you have to write. You're forced to write to each other. So you have to expose yourself, show intelligence, whatever, you know, and so that's what we did for a month. We were not alone, and always kids, and then after a month, I go to her house one night to go hang out with her and the kids and everybody on the couch, and you know, she shows up at the door wearing this really nice, like, kind of like sexy robe or whatever, and the house is dark and there's music playing. I go, hey, where's the kids? She goes, they're gone. Yeah, whatever, it was on, but
they're in the basement.
Yeah, but it was a solid month of like total G-rated dating, which I really dug, because I really, it forced me to get to know her and date the kids.
That's actually cool, you know.
You know,
that's actually great dating advice. So everybody out there, disregard everything I've said about dating. Listen to the founding member of T.S.O.L., Jack Grisham. And with that, if you just tuned in, you are listening to KLEAN Radio. We got to take a break for a second. We will be right back. The discussion continues at KLEAN Radio.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling KLEAN Treatment Centers. KLEAN has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call KLEAN Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.
Welcome back to KLEAN Radio. In studio tonight with founding member of T.S.O.L., Jack Grisham, author, writer, audio book.
Hypnotist. Hypnotherapist, baby.
But, you know, I wanted to, you've been sober a long time.
25 years last week.
25 years last week, and you have fun. You
have a blast.
And I think that's really important, you know, to talk about is, you know, because a lot of people out there, you know, you always hear, you know, you played music, and how many times have you heard somebody say, I can't do it sober? You know, I can't do these, somehow people have linked the being creative
right
with, I mean, you almost seem more creative now.
Well, I went through that same thing that a lot of these guys do, and that's how I first got interested in hypnosis, because I went to a hypnotist. Because I'll tell you, when I stopped drinking, my ass got tight. I mean tight. Like, I got whiter and whiter. You know what I mean? Like, not whiter, whiter. It's like, it felt like when I walked out of a store without buying something, like I was shoplifting. That's what it felt like. I'd walk into a club, and it seriously, like, it was like a piece of metal just went up my ass. I mean, wow. I don't know what to do, and I'm a geek, and, you know, it's like, it felt like I was at a sci-fi convention, you know, everywhere I went. And so I went to a
Apparently that last word, just for heads up, we can't say again.
Oh, the ASS?
Yes. I don't even know if we're allowed to spell it, but yes.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Because the kids at my house are allowed to say it.
It's bad when the FCC got rules that are stronger than us.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'll watch that. But so I went to a hypnotist. Because I'm thinking, I can't get on stage, man. I don't know how to do this without a couple of cocktails in me. And I went down. It was really cool. I went and saw this hypnotherapist, and I didn't know what was going to happen. Because the guy had some, like, Lambda stuff up and pride posters, and it's downtown Long Beach, right? So I'm thinking, I'm going to lay out in the chair, and then all of a sudden something's going to go on my cheek. You know, he's going to go, that's gum. That's delicious. Because I didn't know what was going to happen,
I think he chewed gum, maybe a lollipop.
Yeah, whatever it is.
You know, it's funny. That was actually an episode of Arliss. I don't know if you've ever seen that show, but yeah, that happened. But anyways, go on.
Well, so anyway, so then he took me back to this favorite show I played. He goes, "What's your best show? What was the funnest?" So he took me back to it. It was actually a show where there was a riot and all this stuff. So then when I got on stage, that show would always come to mind. Huh. And it really helped me. But now, you know, after being clean this long, it's like, I love it. I mean, I do everything. You guys were talking about temperature changes. I was in Sweden. It was 20 below.
Oh, my God.
And then I flew down to Zihuatanejo, and it was 90 above. So it was 110 difference.
You were like on a Shawshank Redemption tour?
Oh, it was killer. Yeah. Zihuatanejo. That's where they went.
And I got back. I had to crank my air conditioning to, like, 64 because I was, like, sweating because it was, like, 70. I was like, it's too hot. I'm like.
Well, I heard this great story one time. I was in this 12-step group down in Charlotte, and this guy was telling this story about a bear. And, you know, they used to have these bears behind gas stations, or they'd have a lion or a bear. Like, when I first started going on road trips, you'd see them, see the bear, see whatever, and you'd come
roadside
up.
Roadside attractions.
Yeah, it was sad, man. It was like this bear in a cage. Well, this guy told this story about this bear, and it could go 3 feet up, 5 feet over, 3 feet up, 5 feet over. It was in this cage. That's all the room it had. Huh. So they break it out of the cage, they take it out of the wild, let it go, and it's wide open, and the bear goes 3 feet up, 5 feet over, because that's all it knows. And I can't tell you the amount of people that I have seen come in and get clean and sober, and they bring the cage with them, and now the cage is gone, and they're still 3 and 5, 3 and 5, 3 and 5, and they don't realize how free they are and what they can do. It's like being clean, once you have that spiritual shift or that awakening, it's like, man, what do you want to do?
I think part of that also is that, you know, you become so isolated when you're drinking, using drugs, you know, and like you do put yourself in that cage, and then you forget all the skills that you may have had, or maybe that you didn't have, and that you relied on alcohol and other drugs to, like, disinhibit you to be able to do things that you didn't want to own, or you didn't feel like you were responsible for. Like, oh, I was drunk, so it's fine that I, you know, shot up my friend's house.
Yeah, like, there's no excuse now. It's like, what do you say? I was way too sober yesterday, my friend. There was too much step work going on.
Remember when I called you blank, blank, blank? You know, I was sober, man. I'm sorry.
I've had so many of those. I'll tell you, I've acted worse sober than people at my bottom. I mean,
I say that all the time. I've been more stupid sober than I ever could have imagined doing drugs.
You bet. And some parts of my sobriety, I mean, it's like, you know, I lost my favorite nephew to a drug overdose. The first girl I married lost to a drug overdose. I've been homeless. At 20 years sobriety, I was homeless, living out of a car. I was living in an office for a while, bankrupt, you know, everything, man. But it's just never, I don't know, whatever. I've gone through all that stuff.
but you've been through it all sober.
Yeah.
And that's the amazing thing sometimes.
Well, and I think so, too, the biggest shift in attitude. Like, back then, when I was drinking and doing whatever, I'd get a flat tire in my car, and I'd pull over and lay down. You know what I mean? It's like, this is it. I'm done. You know, and now you go through stuff, but there always seems like, hey, something good's coming. You're just going through this. It's almost like a real detachment to the problem. Like I see the problems going on. I'm aware of it. We're dealing with it. But I'm not attached to this.
Yeah, it's called Better Coping Skills.
You bet.
You just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. You're listening.
You want to get all clinical.
You're listening to Jack Grisham, founding member of T.S.O.L., Andrew Spanswick. And, you know, the reason I love talking about this is because somebody else asked on Facebook, why did you guys start the show? And, you know, one of the reasons we started the show was that, we'd have dialogue.
Right, because Jude and I weren't speaking enough.
Yeah, that's nice. We needed to talk more. And also because we wanted to show those things, that you can have that life sober, that that you can have an amazing life.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you a cool story. I was down and I really want to blow this. I want to break this guy's thing, but I'm not going to break his anonymity. But I'm not going to. So we're down in Jacksonville. I'm down in Jacksonville. And this guy's saying he's going to kill himself. In the group.
Yeah.
And he's serious, man. Like, right. I can tell. It's like, man, this guy's, like, going, you know? Right. And everyone's just sitting there. And so I come up to him afterwards. I go, dude, man, I got an idea. And I was on tour at the time in a crappy old van with a bunch of dudes, you know?
Right.
And I go, look, man. I go, why don't you come with me? And he goes, what? I go, look, you're gonna off yourself, dude.
Yeah, so what are you going to lose?
What are you going to do, man? I go, just get in the van with me right now. And we're going to drive off.
It's stinky van before homicide.
Before
suicide.
That's right. I go, because I'm clean, you're going to come along, right?
Right?
So the guy goes, well, let me go to my apartment, get some things. I go, no, bro. I go, you come as is. You're rolling as is. I go, let's just pretend you're dead right now.
Yeah, right.
You're not getting anything. Here's your chance. You go home and shoot yourself,
right,
or you go get in the van over there.
Right.
And he goes, I'll get in the van. So he walks over, gets in the van, right? I had this dude with me for 2 weeks. 2 weeks he was with me.
Wow.
We went all over, went to clubs, whenever, you know, went skiing down in the Keys, just diving, did all this stuff, man. At the end of 2 weeks, he looks at me and goes, all right, I'm in. I want to live. Right? And the guy's still been 20 years.
Wow,
20 years
great.
Sober. You know, it's crazy. And he's in a huge band, and he travels all over. He's getting ready. He just sent me a wedding invitation, you know,
wow.
And it's like, you know, a great friend, man. And he's
this is a new treatment.
Yeah.
It's the Stinky Guy Van Treatment Center.
That's it. We're going to beat the fun into you, champ. Well, that's it. You know, and hopefully.
But, you know, we do that. We have sober fun. We take people out. And it's amazing. Like, people think, you know, you get, like, to the point where you're so sick, you just feel like you can't do anything. You know, and then you show people that, oh, wow, all these things that you sort of forgot about. It's like being married, like, and then you get divorced, and all of a sudden you realize, oh, I really like that other kind of music.
Okay.
I don't know, man.
That's a personal issue.
Yeah. You want to stop and maybe discuss this off air for a little bit?
But you're right. It's years ago when I lived in Israel, I had a drug counselor at the time. I was in rehab, and he took me to see Radiohead open for REM. In Israel, this is about 18 years ago. And after the concert, he goes, there's one thing you'll never be able to tell me. You didn't have fun. You know, you couldn't have fun sober. And he goes, you're not going to stay sober, but you're always going to remember that you could have fun.
Right.
And I never forgot that. I never, because I always had the, you know, would always say, it's no fun sober. Like, I knew.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And, but I had seen it. I had been to the show, not just, you know, and I knew. And it sounds like what you did for that guy.
Well, and a lot of it's like, what kind of fun do you want to have?
Yeah.
It's like
yeah.
finding people that share your interests. You know, maybe your idea of fun is, you know, I got a friend that reenacts World War II battles.
Right.
Bitchin', you know? Yeah. I mean, he's,
or sci-fi conventions.
Or sci-fi conventions, or even reading poetry together. I was in this group with these guys, and we read Shakespeare every Saturday. You know, it was really fun, man. Yeah. My friend Fred, down there, Fred and Lynn, we'd go over to their house, and we get out the book, and we'd act out parts of the plays. You know, it was great. Went through all the tragedies. It was really fun, man. You know, I mean, I'm a total geek. I loved it. You know, it's like,
There's a group up in Washington where our hospital is. It's, you know, a bunch of guys. They get together for professional wrestling night. And I swear to God, it's just ridiculous. And only one of them believes it's real in the whole group. Like, the rest of them think it's fake, right?
They all wrestle together.
They all know it's fake, except for this one guy who's like, you can argue with them all in there. He's like, no, it's definitely real. And they're like saying it's fake on the TV. He's like, no, it's real, I'm telling you. I'm just like, oh my God.
That'd be killer if they put on the costumes and then reenacted.
Dude, they have the belt. They have the wrestling, like, a copy of it. And then whoever wins, like, this contest they have every night about guessing who's gonna win, like, gets the belt for the week.
Oh, that's killer.
And like, this one guy who never got it, like, finally got it. He was like holding it out the window, driving around town, honking his horn. You know, he's like, I won. I'm the wrestler.
I gotta tell you, I might want to go there. If you just tuned in, you're listening to Clean Radio. We're in the studio tonight with Jack Grisham. The number is 800-222-5222. That's 800-222-5222. What's going on now? I know you have something else coming out, a new book.
Yeah, I got a new book coming out in a couple. Well. coming out maybe in a month or two. Now, the printing issue. The book's, it's kind of a little bit about necrophilia a little bit. So we're having some this printing.
Is
from your,
this is more than hypnosis, I guess. This is the second session of hypnosis.
Well, it was a joke. There was like this T.S.O.L. song that was famous called Code Blue. And, right. it was a joke. Everyone thinks it's about necrophilia, and it's not. It's this kid saying, hey, I don't. He's a teenage boy, because I wrote it when I was a teen. It's like, hey, he's a teenage boy. And he was having trouble dating at school with all that goes on.
Right.
And he says, hey, I would rather go sleep with a dead person than be in up here.
Right.
Because dead people will let me do whatever I want. And they don't complain. You know, it's like, and that's the song, you know. And it's a funny song. I mean, Jed the Fish from K-Rock said one time, he goes, I bet Jack's killing himself. The best song he ever wrote, nobody can play. Because it's got the F word in it like 30 times. You know, I want to blah the dead, you know.
And, my favorite thing about the show right now is I'm watching Steve the engineer, just like his finger, you know, he's so
he's
close
on the dump button.
He's like, please God, please.
Hey, I'm watching it, man. I'm a professional.
You're doing a good job.
You know, just so you know, I think the two of you, when we were on that different station, Andrew definitely.
I screwed up a few times.
You screwed up a few times, and that's what makes it fun. So you got this. So you got a book about necrophilia.
No. So it was just like a short story, but I got my buddy Scott Eicher, and great illustrator. He illustrated Untamed, the second. Right. Book. I wrote An American Demon, and then I wrote Untamed, and then I wrote this one, Code Blue, A Love Story. And I got Skye Eicher illustrating it. So it's a short book. It's like a children's book for adults with adult photos in it. I guess with adult illustration.
I think that's called porn.
Is that what it is? Yeah, I know. And that's the issue we had with a couple of printers. Yeah. It's like, whoa, hey, come on, man. Right. No. So now we had to go to Hong Kong and do it. But wow. We sent the book to...
I love it. It's underground Asian porn now. It's like this whole new career for you, man. It's like...
You know what's amazing is that you're still being creative. That same punk thing you did then... Or I say punk, I sound like I know what
well,
I'm talking about.
Well, but it's
about.
Like, it's an attitude, yeah. You know? It's definitely, still, I mean, there's something about still being, you know, free to, like,
and
talk
to
and not give it,
yeah.
You know.
Well, and I do, and it, no, the other cool thing that's fun, I write a weekly column for the OC Weekly, the paper down there. And
the Orange County Weekly.
The Orange County Weekly, OC Weekly, and it's a short story, 500 words. And they asked me, they said, hey, do you want to do an advice column? I go, no, I don't give advice, man. it's like, I don't want somebody coming to me saying, dude. Right. I took your advice.
Except for unless you're going to kill yourself and he has his van outside.
Well, positive. Yeah, positive. So I said, look, if you let me write whatever I want, then okay. So they said, okay, so I write short stories
every
week.
That's really cool.
A short story a week, you know.
Yeah, it's like Bukowski's old column. You got like, you know.
Yeah, it's fun, you know, and they pay me unbelievable pay.
That's great.
Yeah, unbelievable meaning unbelievable, but it's fun. So I do that and just write and write, and I'm working on four novels right now. It's like I got four going. Wow. There's not enough time. Yeah. I tell people, man, when I was out there before, I was done. Yeah. You know, there's a great scene in Kingpin, that Woody Harrelson vehicle. You know, Woody Harrelson, Bill Murray.
You're so
vehicle.
LA now, man.
I just saw that on whatever, Tropic Thunder. I love that.
I love that movie.
Yeah, that Andrew Dice Clay vehicle. So there's a great scene. All these drunks are laying out against the wall, and they're drinking, right? And Woody Harrelson rolls up and goes, how's life? And they go, long. And that's how it felt. I was 26, and it was long. Like, it was long, man. Yeah. And now I'm 52, and I'm thinking, it's short. Too short.
It goes faster as you get older. Yeah. I have to break it to you.
Let's go to Tony in Portland. Tony, welcome to Clean Radio.
Hey, how you guys doing tonight?
Good, Tony. What's up? How are you doing, Tony?
Well, you know, I've listened to your show a couple of times, and I've been struggling with opiate addiction for, probably a little over 5 years. And I've had back surgery, shoulder problems, knee surgery, and doctors have put me on opiates time and time again. And I'm to the point where, you know, I'm over-medicating and supplementing, and I just reached the end of my rope, and I have decided to do something about it come when my vacation comes up at my employer, and I don't want to do it and let my employer know what's going on, so...
Have the physical problems, Tony, that started you using opiates, have they been resolved?
Have they what?
The physical problems that made you use opiates, have they cured themselves or have they been fixed?
No, I'm still in a lot of pain, but.
Mm-hmm. And what's what kind of pain? What type of pain is it?
Like, well, it's knee pain.
How old are you?
I'm 42.
42. Wow. I know the feeling. I'm a little older, but without the opiates.
So Tony, where are you going to get help? How are you going to get help?
Well, that's the reason I'm calling. Okay. You know, I have a month and a half before my vacation comes up, and I have excellent health care, Blue Shield Blue Cross, and I was wondering, should I go to a regular hospital or should I go to...
Yeah, what kind of medication are you on right now? How much are you taking?
I've been taking oxycodone.
Uh-huh. How much have you been taking?
I take up to 70 milligrams a day.
Explain, is that a lot?
I'm not going to say it's not a lot, but it's, you know, so have you tried reducing it slowly on your own?
I have, and it is so difficult. I'm violently ill. I get, you know, bouts of diarrhea and just...
Yeah, well, the problem is with opiates is they constipate you when you reach, like, the regular level, and then when you start coming off them, your body just freaks out. So,
how long does it take to get off them?
You know, the thing is, it really depends on how long you've been on them, and there's different detox methods for different types of clients. So, but I would definitely suggest that you go somewhere where you can get an actual medical detox.
A rehab clinic.
Yeah, you know, you could do it outpatient, or but I think you'd probably have a lot more success, especially if you're on a short time frame with work, to do it in a residential setting, so you got somebody watching you and making sure that you're safe. It's, you know, it's kind of dangerous coming off opiates, and if you can't just come off all at once, and you know, there's a lot of different alternatives about how to detox off them. But if you've been on for a long time, I'm sort of a big believer on actually slowly coming off it and not going cold turkey through like some aggressive detox. Because the studies have been showing more and more now that people that actually work for a longer time, give themselves a little time to get off it, especially at the amount you're taking, have better outcomes than people that just go cold turkey and then are just sort of out there. It's just too much all at once. So, you know, that's what we do. I mean, you can look us up on the website, cleancenter.com, clean with a K. And yeah, you can read all about what we do. And then, if you call 888-601-6040, which is also on our website, we have treatment advisors and they can either direct you to a place near you that's outpatient or, you know, talk about what services we offer as well.
Wow. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And,
did you get that number?
Well, I'm driving right now. So
yeah, just go to the website. So it's KLEANCENTR. And there's like...
with a K.
Yeah, we got great clinicians that are on call 24/7. And we refer a lot of people out to local areas if we don't have a facility near you. We're mostly in Washington and Astoria, Oregon. Long Beach, Washington, Astoria, Oregon, and West Hollywood. But we partner and work with a lot of other facilities as well that we recommend.
And listen, Tony, even when you get home and you just need somebody to talk to, that call is absolutely free. Feel free to talk to them. Jack, what he's going through right now has got to be one of the scariest things in the world because he knows he's at that place where it's not working.
Well, also where you're pushing it off. Like I'm dealing this with another client right now who he's decided he's going to get sober on February 15th. Well, it was February 10th last week. Now it's February 15th, right? Yeah. So it's this thing, you know, like when are you going to actually do it? And, you know, there's always an excuse not to start. And, you know, that's one of the things is like actually when you have the willingness to actually do it, it's important that you try to start treatment as soon as possible because it can get really easy to like have that anxiety about getting off of, especially opiates. People are really scared to get off opiates. But, you know, if you go to a really good treatment center, they can get you off it without going through a lot of withdrawal symptoms that you're talking about. We have really good detox protocols now that, and a lot of people have argued that we shouldn't do that. And we're one of the treatment centers that actually uses a really soft, kind sort of approach to detox. The old school method used to have it be that, you know, they give you a hard detox thinking
it
somehow so that you'd feel it and like sort of like get this blame for having been addicted to opiates. But I found that doesn't work. It just makes people, you know, even more miserable. So our thing is to like get people off it safely and comfortably as comfortable as possible. Yeah, because what you're really getting, the hardest part actually isn't physically getting off of opiates. It's all of a sudden having to feel again.
Yeah.
because, you know, opiates stop you from feeling. It stops you from sort of like thinking and worrying about all the stuff that's going on in your life. And it numbs you. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, it's taken a toll on my marriage. It's taken a toll on my sexual disposition. Yeah. It's just, you know, I mean, and the worst part about it is the ill feeling that I feel continuously when I jump from 70 milligrams down to 10 or 20.
I mean, that's a huge jump. Yeah, you really need to be careful, Tony. I mean, you know, never make a change in your medication without talking with a doctor or a physician that prescribed it. And, you know, it's the most important thing I can say to anybody out there. And also remember, the number one form of overdose is when people are doing one thing and they mix it with another thing. Most people that die of overdoses, they're doing opiates and then they mix it with alcohol or mix it with something else. So most people don't overdose on one drug alone. So be very, very careful. And, you know, you always talk to your doctor before making a change in your medication.
Okay, Tony, give us a call. The second you get home, give us a call.
I really appreciate your time. And
no problem, Tony. Hey, it can get a lot better. Hang in there, yeah. All right, man?
Listen to Jack.
I can't wait to have a follow-up testimonial call with you guys when I'm clean.
There you go. Nice, I love that. That'd be great, Tony. Look forward to it.
And I will not ride this stinky van. Yeah.
And listen, get home safe, Tony.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Talk to you soon.
Yep, no problem.
Yeah, I just had a side, on a little quick side thing.
Yeah. Listen to the mic.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I just had a little side thing with this. I just quit sugar, the whites, right? Stop the whites, right? And and I did this. I said I was willing, but I said, you know what? Christmas is coming, and so I'm going to do it the day after Christmas, right? That's what I said. But basically by doing that, I gave myself license to just go nuts.
Right.
You're like, well, I'm going to quit day after Christmas. Pass that Tootsie Roll, you know, whatever it was. Right. And then I got a colonoscopy done to me. You know, I got all checked out. And I rolled in, and when they weighed me, they threw out a figure, and I thought, oh, my God, man, because that giving myself a license to go nuts,
right.
It was the biggest I'd ever been, man. And I just looked at the dude and said, I'm done. You know, this is it. You know, I'm not putting any date off in the future. It's like, this is it today, you know, and I'm down 20 pounds.
It sounds like he's at that day, and we've all had that. We're at that place. It's like, you know, that moment where we can't imagine life with it. We can't imagine life without it.
The jumping off.
And
it just gets too hard, man, you know?
It is. And it sounded like everything he knows.
Well, the weird thing is a lot of people have to lose so much before they actually get help. And that's what I hate to see, you know, where people like lose their marriage. They lose connection with their family. They lose respect from other people. And, you know, I like the fact that a lot of people are getting treatment now, maybe before they're an alcoholic or before they're an addict. They start seeing that they're beginning to get in a cycle of abuse of substances. And then they learn that, you know, maybe I don't really want to go down that whole path. And they make adjustments earlier. And we're seeing more and more of that now.
Yeah, and so. I think the one thing about that, too, also, is that we've, in the recovery community, that we got to watch how we talk in group.
Yes.
A lot of times. Because people are so hung up on all these war stories.
Yeah, you
got to
be the biggest, baddest drug addict ever.
Exactly.
Because it's a spirit, you know, and I always say
they make fun of people. Yeah. They're just like, oh, you know, I drink every night and it was bothering me. Well, you know, drinking every night is not good for you.
And that's me.
No.
And you don't have to, like, lose your job, lose your wife, and, like, you know, beat up 30 people and been in a punk rock band to be cool.
Jack, when I moved out to L.A., I had a 5.5 years sober. I'm an alcoholic. You know, I'm a recovering alcoholic. Alcohol was my thing.
Right.
And I came out here and people were talking about drugs that I'd never heard of. They were shooting them into places I didn't know you could do.
Yeah, yeah.
And they had tattoo rings all, I mean, their whole body was a tattoo. And I'm like, do I belong here?
Yeah.
And that's at 5.5 years sober. And that's when I really learned that it's a spiritual bottom that people go through. It doesn't matter finances. It's where you are in here.
Well, and there's a quick line. I mean, in some of the 12-step literature, there's a line I always point people to because I might have been a bit of a mess.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But I don't push that because it's like it doesn't benefit anybody.
Right.
But there's a line where it says, you know, how do you know if you're an alcoholic or not? And they're dealing with alcohol, how do you know if you're an alcoholic or not? It says when you want to quit, can you quit entirely?
Right.
Meaning if you ever stopped, why'd you pick it back up again? Yeah, right. You ever get sick in the morning and say, I'm not going to do it? Why'd you do it again? Ever promise a wife, husband, kids you wouldn't do it? Ever go to jail? Ever been in trouble? Ever tell yourself, hey, I'm not doing it? Yeah. Why couldn't you stay stopped? It's got nothing to do with losing money, going to jail.
Right.
None of that crap.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, you quit. Why couldn't you stay quit? Yeah. It's a real simple question.
And we're running out of time. I just wanted to get a quick call quickly, Jack. It's almost like it's this call is a gift to you because it's Todd calling from Oregon, and he's in the institution where One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest was shot.
He's actually a client there now. Part of his treatment plan. He has to call us every week.
Part of his treatment plan is that he's got he calls in and listens to the show. So, Todd, you like that introduction?
Yeah, how can you guys give the institutionalized guy the burning desire gig?
Because we like the echo of the institution in the background.
It's wonderful, man. Moments of clean radio. Yeah. I mean, I can't think of anything more.
Hey, I got a question for Jack. Is Good Charlotte really punk?
Oh, I don't know. You know, I mean, they're nice guys. I just look at, you know how I deal with it? If people are nice, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, because you got guys that are supposedly punk. And they're worse than anyone you ever saw. It's like there's no punk's an attitude, not a sound. It's not a sound or way they look. It's an attitude, and either you got that kind of thing or you don't have that thing.
A lot of punk guys are now in electronica. I mean, like it's the genre of music hasn't really is changed for a lot of that sort of mindset. And like they used to say that punks from the 70s were really like the hardcore hippies from the 60s. You know, and switch into punk. I mean, you know.
I was just a criminal. I don't know.
You're just a degenerate.
Like, people always ask me, they say, were you even into the music? It's like, nah, it's a backdrop for a robbery. Yeah. What are you talking about?
Hey, I did get a new environment, though.
They gave you a window?
They reverse transferred me to Maximum, and with all the guys that can't aid and assist in their trial. And it's a real refreshing crowd, actually, compared to the chronic.
Now, see, look at Todd's got a good attitude, man.
Todd, what's the plan to get you out of there, man? Yeah. How long are you going to be in there?
What his plan is.
I'm talking to my lawyer right now about a full discharge, and I just approached one of the head power drivers hear about it. I said, hey, man, I got 2 years clear conduct.
All right, we're going to start a free Todd campaign.
That's nice, David. The dream, by the way, is, Jack, just so you know, is that there's a mental breakout. Somehow, like, a bunch of mental patients raid Salem, Oregon.
Right.
So that the hospital's overfilled and they could let him out of his sentence early.
Oh, very nice, yeah.
And, Jack,
we're out of time. Thanks, Jack.
Jack Grisham, how do people find your new book?
Real easy. Go to just jackgrisham.com, www.jackgrisham.com, and click on the picture. The dead girl. That'll take you right to the book, baby.
And Andrew, it's good to see you.
Good to see you,
as always. Yeah. I'd like to thank everybody out there that helps put on the show. Steve, Rand,
and thanks
Patrick.
To all our fans, man.
Thank you, everybody that listens.
Thanks for having me.
The discussion continues at KLEANradio.com.
Are you or someone you care about addicted to drugs or alcohol? Addiction ruins lives and destroys families. Bring an end to the pain and suffering by calling KLEAN Treatment Centers. KLEAN has helped people from around the world break free by not only treating the addiction, but the underlying causes and providing vital aftercare so people can get clean and stay clean with no gimmicks and no false promises. If you need immediate assistance or just have questions, call KLEAN Treatment Centers for guidance. A much better life awaits.